If you want action, if you want answers, it's time to get results with Richard Rice.
Welcome back to Results with Richard Rice. I am the host of the show, and we want to welcome all our listeners back. This is actually our second show, so we're excited about that. We have a great guest with us today, a very knowledgeable attorney, colleague, and a brother, Mr. Ontario Tillman of the Maxwell Law Firm, soon to be Maxwell Tillman.
That's correct.
That's right. Welcome to the show. How are you feeling this evening?
Hey, I feel good. I appreciate you having me on today.
Yes, sir. It's definitely our privilege and honor to have you on the show. And, you know, we got a lot of questions for you. We're going to learn more about who you are and how you're managing your practice in downtown Birmingham. And we have an exciting topic today. We're going to be speaking about the Stand Your Ground law here in Alabama.
Absolutely.
And we're going to talk a little bit about the nuts and bolts, the fundamentals with it. But we're also going to speak a little bit about the application, you know,
yes,
because it's obviously something that is going to be applied, you know, at first instance by the police, and then the prosecutor is going to, you know, have a decision to make, and then even potentially a jury and a
yes,
judge as well. And so we want to talk about how this, the law in black and white, is played out through perception, you know, and in our society, is, you know, we definitely have to always take into account one's socioeconomic status and their race as well. So we want to get into those topics on the show. But first, you know, I just want to talk a little bit about the origin, the birth of Results with Richard Rice. You know, it's a critical part of the legal practice that I'm involved in with the Rice Firm LLC, which is a public interest law firm. What we really want to do with the show is begin to elevate public awareness, bring mm-hmm. attention and knowledge to the public so that we can empower them to sometimes take a more proactive role in preventing some of the legal issues that may cause us to, you know, even need an attorney. And then in some instances, when we're dealing with public interest law, an individual may have a particular legal issue that has ramifications on society mm-hmm. as a whole or on the general public. And so the only way we can really be able to work collectively and cooperate to bring about a difference is if we're, you know, all have this fundamental baseline information. And so Results with Richard Rice is a step in that direction to begin to bring awareness to some of these key issues like the Stand Your Ground law.
Yeah, and I want to say congratulations to you on creating this type of show and this type of platform, which is needed.
Yes, sir.
And it's a big congratulations to you on that.
I appreciate that. I really do. And it's really important for us as colleagues and members of this, you know, this age-old profession. I try to think about, you know, how long the legal profession has been around, you know, since
long time.
I know biblical times, right? And
yeah,
so it's just one of those things where it makes you really, for me, when I say humility, I don't really mean bowing down, but it really yeah, makes me, you know, feel honored to be a member of this profession.
Absolutely.
And I also want to, you know, carry the torch well while I'm
yeah,
while I'm able to do so, because I know that we stand on the shoulders of so many other great attorneys that have come before us.
Yes, absolutely. So many great attorneys. And it's a great profession, even though sometimes it's not viewed that way
right,
by the public at large. But
yeah,
as I always say, you love a lawyer when you need one.
That's it. Hey, I'm telling you, you took the words out of my mouth. I was about to say that. It's like, everybody has their favorite lawyer joke, and
exactly,
they all have this
exactly,
perception of how bad lawyers are, you know. But when they need one, they need one, and they love you.
Absolutely,
you know, you can become
best friend.
That's it.
They
exactly,
call you all the time, text
all the
you
time,
all the time. You're right.
That's it, man. I tell you, you just you, and it's like a 24 hour, 7 day a week type of job
as
well.
It never closes.
Yeah, and it's a labor of love. You got to really be passionate about it. To do it the right way.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, yeah, it's good to have you on the show. I just want to give a shout out to Rhonda Robinson and Carmine Communications,
yes,
because they've done an excellent job in terms of really helping us create this platform
mm-hmm.
and allowing us to be able to have this type of dialogue and conversation on the air. And this is really the first step. You know, this
yeah,
is the first
yeah,
step. This is our second show. So we're still learning. We're growing. We're going to be working out some of the wrinkles and kinks and all
yeah,
of those things that happen when you first start something new.
Yeah.
But it's a learning process, a growing process. So we're educating the public, but we appreciate y'all's feedback too. And so if you see ways to help us improve the show or just topics that you'd like for us to talk about, potential guests, things like that, feel free to, you know, let us know. You can reach out to me on a firm's website, of course, and you can call into the show. This is Talk Radio. So if you're listening, you have a question, call in at 205-941-1011, or you can call in at 1-866-551-9933. We definitely like to have your feedback on the show. And so, that's enough about the show right now. I want to talk about our guests. I want to give you an opportunity to tell us about yourself, Mr. Tillman, where you're from, what law school you went to, how long you've been in practice, and tell us about the practice and some of the new beginnings that you're experiencing right now.
Okay, well, born and raised in Bessemer, Alabama, and I've been practicing right now for since 2012.
Okay.
I attended Miles Law School.
Okay.
I graduated in 2012, and I've been practicing ever since.
Right.
I opened my first office in Bessemer. I opened it in Bessemer, and that's my hometown, and I wanted to go back to, you know, to help the people of the city of Bessemer, and I was proud to do so.
Right.
I also attended Alabama A&M University, which, you know, go Bulldogs. I always got
that's
to,
right. Hey, I'm from Huntsville. I'm with you on that all the way.
You got to let that be known. And other than that, I started off with my practice in criminal defense,
right,
as well as some domestic relation with family law, things of that nature.
Okay.
And recently, in 2017, I started doing of counsel work with Leroy Maxwell.
Yes, sir.
And we've been practicing together ever since.
Right.
And just recently became a partner.
Well, congratulations on that.
Appreciate it.
Yep.
And so now we call Maxwell Tillman.
Right.
So we handle a lot of criminal defense issues as well as civil rights.
Definitely.
And we also do personal injuries and you know, still do some domestic relations as well as family.
Excellent, excellent. And so, Maxwell Tillman is a firm that's growing really quickly. You all have handled some high-profile cases.
Yes.
I can't think of the name of the young lady, but it was the a case involving rape out of University of Alabama.
Yeah,
and it was
Rondini case.
Yeah, the Rondini case. And there was a poor response from the administration and actually some efforts to cover it up by local officials and everything. And I don't know, you guys may not be able to talk about that specifically.
Yeah, we can't really talk about it right now. But
that just means you did your job well. And, you know, so you all have handled all types of cases. And if, you know, whenever I'm have any type of criminal cases, Leroy is usually the first person I reach out to because I've known him. But now I can actually reach out to you as well. This is our first time actually formally meeting, even though I've, you know, been paying attention to you becoming a part of the firm and now being a partner. You got your lovely family here with you, too, as well. Yes, you want to give them a shout-out for sure for being here and supporting you.
My lovely wife, Yvette Tillman, and my daughter, Aria.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
That's good, man.
They wanted to come and hang out and see how things done.
Definitely, yeah.
And like you said about Leroy, excellent attorney.
Yeah.
You know, it was a no-brainer to actually want to partner with him.
Right. Yeah, I can see both of you guys are, you know, family men. You got a good foundation, and that's something that's necessary because, like we talked about, this job can, you know, 24/7, it can pull you in so many different directions.
Yeah, definitely.
It's good to have that type of support at home and really remind you why you do it sometimes, you know. And you all just moved into a new office downtown, a great location, next door to one of my favorite restaurants
right
that I really
can't
afford to eat at anymore. But it's next door to Yo Mama's.
Yes,
and
the food is great. we spend most of our time over there trying to eat the food.
I understand.
Instead of practicing, but moving to a great location.
Right.
And you need to come by and check it out.
I will.
It's a nice location.
Definitely will do so. I know you all had like an event over there for Joe Singelman.
For Joe Singelman.
Just
great
like maybe
event. A great event. Turned out to be great, and you know, we just excited.
Yeah, it was a good event. I wish I could have made it there. I'm really impressed with the way that that Joe and his team are running that campaign.
Mm-hmm.
So we're looking forward to having some good results out of that.
Exactly. He will be great as the AG of the state of Alabama.
Definitely. So, you know, we have a short show, 30 minutes. You know, we really want to try to jump into our topic here. We're going to be talking about the Stand Your Ground law, specifically here in Alabama.
Mm-hmm.
And so you are the resident expert today, Attorney Tillman. So tell us.
I don't know how much I would believe that.
Yes, sir. You are. You are definitely indeed. And so tell us a little bit about Stand Your Ground law in the state of Alabama, just generally, what are, you know, the basics of it? What do our guests, our listeners need to know?
In a nutshell, Alabama allows, it's Alabama self-defense law,
right,
which allows a person to defend themselves or protect themselves from unlawful physical force that is being used against them. And the person who the force is being used against has to reasonably believe that they are in the threat of imminent force or some unlawful harm.
Right, exactly. And so that's a good description. I think that's something that everybody can digest and comprehend and be able to go out and talk to their friends about it later and kind of have a more informed conversation about some of these stories that are going on in the media. But, like, what's the basic distinction between stand your ground law and just a general self-defense?
Well, you know, in Alabama, they removed the element of retreat.
Okay.
You don't have to retreat anymore. So essentially standing your ground. So if you are met with some type of unlawful force, you can actually stand your ground to defend yourself. And also has to be a degree to it as well. So the way some judge that I read a while ago, that it has to be a slap has to be met with a slap. You know, you can't, someone slaps you and then you go get a gun and shoot them.
Right.
That's the misapplication of it. Yeah. So it has to be met with the same degree of force that is being used against you.
Right. Yeah, I mean, and that's similar to some of the things we talk about with police in terms of, you know, this continuum of force and, you know, maybe even some correctional officers, they used to use that as their standard. I don't know if they still do, but it's still a useful tool to kind of think about it. You know, if someone pushes you or slaps you, then is it really reasonable that you feel like that your life is in danger?
Yeah.
And so could you use deadly force in that situation?
And it's not personal. You know,
right.
When you're looking at the reasonable standard, it's an objective standard.
Right.
And you have to look at it from a reasonable person standpoint. So if a reasonable person was in this situation, would they have responded with the same force in the same way?
Mm-hmm.
So like you said, you know, you know, someone slaps you or pushes you, you can't go get a bat and hit them across the head.
Exactly.
And then now you're thinking that, oh, well, I was just standing my ground. No, it doesn't work that way.
Right. Well, that's good information to know, you know. And I guess my next question then is somewhat related. I really want to know then, you know, what is required to invoke this defense? I mean, and, you know, what stage does it take place? Because obviously, if I'm in a position where I felt like I had to defend myself, I've used deadly force, you know, I call the police arrive on the scene, I tell them exactly what happened, maybe I even have a witness here who confirms what I'm saying, surely they're not going to charge me with murder, are they, or how would it work?
Well, everything is based, you know, case by case, you know, situation. Everything is based upon the facts of your case, as well as the evidence of your case.
Right.
Most of the time when you are charged with a manslaughter charge or a murder charge and you want to invoke the stand your ground issue and element into the case, you can do it in a couple of ways. You can do it in a pretrial where you'll have a hearing just on the stand your ground portion of your case. Mm-hmm. And it's a preponderance of the evidence type issue. So if the judge believes that by the preponderance of the evidence that you had a right to stand your ground, then the case is dismissed. You know, you have immunity, you are immune from further prosecution. Even if you do decide to do a pretrial hearing and you are either denied the stand your ground motion, you can still carry the self-defense to the jury trial, where you can ask the judge to give a jury instruction on stand your ground, and now you have to let the jury decide.
Okay, well, that's a really good explanation there. I like that. I mean, that's good information. So you kind of get two bites at the apple,
yes,
so to speak,
do.
In that situation.
Yes, you do. Yeah,
and then,
do.
Like, what about on the very front end of it? Does the police officer, to what extent does a police officer and then a prosecutor have discretion to make a determination that, you know what, this was a justifiable homicide?
Yes.
Clearly, I mean, there's no way that a reasonable juror or judge would find that this was not a justifiable homicide. So is that within the realm of possibility?
Yeah,
that you
absolutely.
It is.
Yeah, absolutely. And based upon the facts, you know, based upon what the police officers gathered from the, you know, the scene of the crime, and when the prosecution come in to review the situation, then they can make that determination.
Excellent, excellent. This is a great conversation that we're having on Stand Your Ground Law in Alabama. This is Results with Richard Rice. We're going to head into a break. We invite you all to join us back on the flip side of that, and we'll continue this conversation with attorney Ontario Tillman.
Thanks for listening to Results with Richard Rice, a Carmine Communication production.
It's hard out here, Mom.
Well, it's time to find Magic City Snowball and cool off.
Where do we find them?
You know, you can find them all over Jefferson, Shelby, and Walker County. The Snowy Bus is available for parties, family reunions, even public events. Let's go call 205-602-1402 for more information.
You are not alone. Magic City Counseling Services is here to help. Give us a call, 205-276-7279.
If you're interested in advertising during Solutions with Rhonda Robinson, email carminecommunications@gmail.com.
Knowing your breasts can save your life. Go to knowyourgirls.org for the facts you need on breast health. Brought to you by Susan G. Komen and the Ad Council.
On the battlefield, there's a saying America's military men and women live by. Never leave a fallen warrior behind, ever. Off the battlefield, Wounded Warrior Project operates with the same goal. Wounded Warrior Project was created to help our men and women returning home with the scars of war, whether those scars are physical or mental. Wounded Warrior Project. We never leave a fallen warrior behind, ever. Learn more about what we do at WoundedWarriorProject.org.
Dare you say that my behavior is unacceptable? So condescending, unnecessary, but critical. I have the tendency of getting very physical. So watch your step, cause if I do, you need a miracle. You dream of dying, make me wonder why I'm even here.
Welcome back to the show. This is Richard Rice on Results with Richard Rice. And we're here this afternoon with attorney Ontario Tillman of Maxwell Tillman, and located in Birmingham, Alabama. Mr. Tillman, go ahead and tell us about where your firm's located and give us the contact information.
Okay. Now,
yeah.
All right. The firm is located at 2326 2nd Avenue North, Birmingham. And you can reach us at area code 205-216-3304.
Perfect. Good. We always want our listeners to be able to follow up with our guests, you know, should they have some follow-up questions or they may have a legal issue.
You can go to our website as well, right. mxlawfirm.com.
Excellent. Excellent. And so before the break, we were talking about stand your ground law. We went through the basics about, you know, what the law entails. We distinguished it from standard self-defense law in Alabama. And we talked about the process and what your defendant would potentially invoke that defense and how that would unfold in a criminal procedure type of manner.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, just I wanted to kind of go ahead and move a little bit beyond that and talk about, you know, move away from an academic understanding to a more practical understanding.
Absolutely.
And, you know, tell me a little bit about what you've seen in terms of how it's applied in terms of what's a reasonable standard for person A or person B. I mean, we may have an inmate who's incarcerated. You know, what's the standard for that person to invoke that type of defense? Or what about a battered woman? Or what about a police officer? Or, you know, someone who's being robbed on the street? You know, all of these different scenarios bring a different set of facts, and we have to be willing to look at one's demographic background and their socioeconomic background. Have you seen any disparities in your time in practice? Or
yeah,
what are your thoughts?
Of course, you know, how the law is applied generally. You know, certain situation, it's applied differently. And as you said, based upon the facts of the case, you know, everything is case by case.
Right.
So if you're looking at the situation, let's say you have person A has an issue with person B, and person A attacks person B and uses a knife. At that moment, person B does not have any requirement to retreat. They can actually stand their ground at that moment and actually can meet the degree of force that is used against them. So if this person has a knife and they are trying to attack you and you feel you reasonably believe that you are in fear of imminent harm at that moment with deadly force, then you can respond in kind.
Right.
So if you had a weapon on you as far as a gun or something like that, if you were to use it, then you can invoke your stand your ground rule at that point.
Okay. Well, that makes sense. I understand that. I could follow that. And I think that's something that our listeners can appreciate. And if you're listening right now, you want to join the conversation, go ahead and give us a call at 205-941-1011 or 1-866-551-9933. We'd love to have you join the conversation. And we were just discussing some of the disparities in which stand your ground laws could be applied. And if you could talk a little bit about this this issue of what is prosecutorial discretion and how does that impact stand your ground law?
Well, the prosecutor at that point in the case will actually review the case, looking at the facts, looking at the evidence, whether or not stand your ground would apply or what type of law to charge this particular person with.
Right.
And if they review the case and they believe that, you know, that the stand your ground applies in this case, they can no charge dismiss the case at that point. So, you know, they do control everything. They control it from the start to finish, you know, up until the jury trial.
Yeah.
And that's just how, you know, that's how our system works.
That's how the system works. And I mean, on one hand, I guess the good side about it is that these are elected officials.
Yes.
So we have within our power to be able to give them a thumbs up or a thumbs down every, you know, election cycle. And it's something that's important, you know, in terms of voting right now here in Jefferson County. On the ballot, we have Jefferson County Sheriff.
Yes.
And we also have the Jefferson County District Attorney on the ballot. And so if you're listening, you know, I would encourage you to do your research and find out, you know, some of the, I guess, the prosecutorial style, some of the beliefs and whatnot of the prosecutor.
Danny Carr
definitely.
Is a great, great
choice.
Yeah, you're out listening, he's a great, great choice.
And yeah, definitely.
You want to vote for him.
That's true, definitely. I would encourage you all to vote for Danny Carr as well. He's running a strong campaign.
Yes, he is.
And the election's in November, so, you know, we're nearing the finish line, but we definitely want to finish strong.
And in Bessemer with District Attorney Washington.
Yes.
Great District Attorney.
Definitely. She is. She's done a good job. And it's my understanding, I believe she was the first black woman to be elected to District Attorney in
Absolutely.
The county.
I call her judge because that's when I met her, when she's a, you know, municipal court judge. So, you know, great District Attorney.
Yeah, you always got to show that deference, you know.
Yes.
She, once a judge, always a judge.
Always a judge, absolutely.
Yeah, definitely. And so, I mean, you know, in anything in our society, you know, race is a factor, and so that can create disparities. Also, one, socioeconomic status. You know, you talked a little bit about the fact that you have two bites at the apple, but you really, in terms of your ability to have competent legal counsel, I mean, that's a big component in your ability to effectively make that argument. And so just based on that factor alone, everyone is not going to have equal access to the law. You know, as attorneys, that's something that we really want to try to guard against. But in some ways, our hands are kind of tied unless we can take these issues to the legislature and make sure that
it's
fair. Yeah, and change it. Yeah.
And we do have, you know, great attorneys at every level.
Right.
You know, we have great attorneys in the public defender's office.
That's true.
You also have great attorneys who are appointed on your case.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of folks kind of look down on appointed attorneys, but they are good attorneys.
Right.
You know, and they are there to do their job, and a lot of them do their job. You know, I was appointed counsel on a lot of cases as well, which is a good thing because it also shows, you know, the judge has confidence in you to actually represent this person in the proper way. And, you know, that's how our system works. And then also, you also can go out and retain an attorney. And, you know, that's where you're saying that the economics come to play in that situation.
That's true. And I mean, we, in my opinion, I believe we're extraordinarily blessed here to be in the city of Birmingham, Bessemer, surrounding Birmingham metro area here in Jefferson County because of, you know, we have elected judges that reflect the demographic makeup of the citizens here. And so a lot of times, you know, we are able to maybe navigate through these disparities differently than you would find in surrounding counties just based on just the historic nature of our country, right? I mean, that's a big factor to consider, too.
Yes, it is. And to be honest, Jefferson County has a great bench.
Right.
It does.
Yeah.
And Birmingham and Bessemer.
Right.
Great bench. You got knowledgeable judges who understand the law and who will apply the law fairly.
Right.
And you really do have that in Jefferson County, and I enjoy practicing in front of all of the judges in Jefferson County.
Most definitely. I definitely would give an amen to that.
Yes,
you know, I agree with you completely on that. And so I wanted to talk a little bit briefly. We're at 3:24. Time flies, I'm telling you.
Yeah.
I want to talk a little bit about the Stand Your Ground issue that has recently arisen in Selma, Alabama. A young lady by the name of Jacqueline Dixon was charged with murder on July 31st after she believed that she needed to use deadly force to defend herself against her husband. Mm-hmm. Now, based on court documents, she had been subjected to domestic violence and abuse at the hands of this individual for several years. And on this particular occasion, she said that she felt as though her life was in danger. This is based on reports that I'm reading online.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then she ultimately used deadly force. She shot the young man a couple of times, twice in the chest. When police arrived on the scene, he was unresponsive. She was charged with murder. Her bond has been set at $100,000. And it's my understanding that she has a preliminary hearing. I don't know if it's the actual stand your ground hearing.
Probably coming the prelim.
Up. Yeah. It's the prelim, yeah. Which comes before the
Pretrial on the stand your ground.
And in this particular case, you know, I don't know all the facts, but, you know, I understand that this is somebody who actually even had a protective order in place, an injunction. Yeah. From a judge that said, you guys got to stay away from each other because one of you has been abusive. And then this lady on this particular occasion felt like her life was in danger, still charged with murder, bond still set $100,000. Mm-hmm. What are your initial thoughts when you hear about that? And what would be some of your concerns if you were, going to be representing someone like Ms. Dixon?
Well, personally, I do believe that stand your ground should apply in that situation.
Right.
When you look at the past domestic violence abuse against her, as well as if you're looking at the PFA that was in place to protect her from that. And then I also would like to know the facts of the encounter. You know, at the moment where she shot the young man and killed the young man, what took place? Did he, attack her? Was he attempting to attack her? Did he have a weapon in his hand? You know, you want to look at all of that information to make sure that when you do have your stand your ground and pretrial hearing, that you can put forth these facts of the case and the evidence of this case so she can be immune from further prosecution. Because based upon what I'm hearing from the report, I do believe that stand your ground should apply.
Right. Yeah. I mean, and it's one of those things where, you know, we hope and pray, and I understand she has a legal team that's going to be representing her in court. And she has so many people even that have reached out to me. I've, done several press releases on her behalf to try to bring attention to this issue, when attorneys from local and afar, from various nonprofits across the nation, local attorneys who have agreed to, you know, offer their time on a volunteer basis. That goes back to your point about, some of these perceptions about economics or the legal practice. Yes, they're true, but there's always exceptions and there's ways around those types of things.
You know, we do tons of work for a lot of people. It's attorneys across the board. You help people whenever you can help people. And that's what we do in this profession. But, you know, it's not celebrated as much because people think about lawyers saying, they only want the money and they want this and they want that. But in a lot of cases, people are out here doing good work.
Definitely. Yeah, that's so true. And that's, you know, we can use this platform to elevate those things.
Yeah,
and we're going to continue to do that and have guests on the show like yourself and Leroy. Y'all are doing great work
here
in Birmingham. And I know y'all going to continue to grow and continue to do positive things out there. And, I just want to, say thank you for being on the show.
No problem.
And I wanted to also, before we call it, come to the end of the show, I wanted to give you an opportunity to talk a little bit about this case involving Botham. Okay. All right. This case called Botham Jean, this young individual out of Dallas, Texas. We actually have a caller on the line, so I'm going to come right back to that thought.
Okay.
But first, let me see if we can take this caller. Hey, caller, thanks for calling in. You're on the air.
Hi, I have a question for your guest.
Sure.
My name is Pam Watson, and I wanted to ask him about the Stand Your Ground law in reference to Trayvon Martin. So I understand he said that you have to use force for force. I think that's what he said. And I'm trying to understand what happened when they got into the fight and he ended up getting killed, and Trayvon Martin didn't even have a weapon on him.
Well, that's the standard barrier of this case. That's me of the stand your ground issue. That's the case that kind of started everything from that point. And you're right. You know, when you're looking at it, you do look at it from the point of degree versus degree of force. But based upon the case, from the facts that I do remember of the case, they were saying that the gentleman, Zimmerman, his head was being bashed against the ground, and he felt at that moment that he was in imminent fear of death or harm and decides to use a weapon to kill young Trayvon.
Right. I mean, thank you for calling in, caller. That was a great question. Mm-hmm. Hopefully you can check us out again next week, Sundays at 3:00 with Results with Richard Rice. We've had a great show. You know, we still have so much more we can talk about. We're going to have Attorney Tillman back again.
I'll gladly come back.
Yes, sir. Good. Well, thank you for joining us again. We're definitely going to have you back on the show. Listeners, thank you for listening in. I want to thank our caller for listening in to Results with Richard Rice. Hope you all have a great weekend, and I'll see you or talk to you next Sunday.
Okay.
Thanks for listening to Results with Richard Rice, a Carmine Communication production.